years for a permanent position, and has been in Gucci since the Hebrew University since 2012. And today he's going to tell us about hyperventilation of TNT centers.
Thank you for the introduction and invitation. So I'm Alex Metzger. I'm a physics professor. I'm working in quantum technology and quantum information, but what I will discuss today, in this sense, it will be a bit of an unusual colloquium. I'm also a co-founder of a company called quantum technology, and I will explain what the company does. So what you see here is a list of papers that we had during the years, which are connected to what the company was based on. But in principle, I will talk about the company. So the company is called Envision, and it's located in it's located in Germany, and there are a few co-founders from Ulm. Device and interact with the eye and then go to the brain. But the measurement itself is not totally clear where it happens, and there is no solution for mechanics to this question. It wasn't such a big problem in the beginning, because that's what was Schrödinger said. It is fair to state that we are not experimenting with single particles any more than we can raise a vacuum to Syria in the zoo. So to Syria is a kind of fish that was living in the times of the dinosaurs. So what I meant by that, if you're a biologist, there's no point in asking the question, what is the metabolism of this fish? Because you will never be able to check. And the same thing with the measurement problem, since you will never make an experiment with a single atom, there's no even point of asking this question, because it's not zero. So he said this at 52, at 53, Wolfgang Pohl had an idea how to actually measure a single particle. And the problem was that the Laplace equation doesn't have a minimum, only have things like this, but if you change it with time in a way like this, it will actually have stable solutions. And you know, because it's the Mathieu equation and it has solutions that you have. And that was the idea, the main idea behind the Pohl trap. So Schrödinger said this in 52, and in 79, this guy, Lohheiser, was the first human to have a single ion. Doesn't look impressive, but it's actually a single ion, and the trap is still in the museum.
What is the single ion?
I'm not
very
sure. That's
what it says.
But the paper was accepted, so I guess it's
okay.
Okay, so we're back to the other problem, and when I started my PhD, actually, the foundation was quite active. There were lots of strange solutions. One of the solutions was the following, the many Morse interpretation. And it says that each time a quantum measurement happens, the universe splits into two. In one, we have one result, in the other result, and the universe keeps splitting and splitting and splitting. And actually, already then, it was like 14 years ago when I started my PhD, so my supervisor was Lev Weidman. He had already created, I think it was the first quantum technology company. And his idea was the following one. Suppose you're a young guy and you want to get married. You have a partner and everything is fine. And then the ex-partner calls you and she wants to marry you as well. So what do you do? So it's a big dilemma. So you call this company, you give them $1. They make a quantum experiment for you. In one universe, you marry your partner. In the other, your ex-partner. And your problem is solved. So surprisingly, they actually made some money from it. But then they closed the company. Because there's only so far you can push this joke. But it was the state of quantum technologies 14 years ago. Today there are many, many companies which don't deal with marriage nor with divorce. So already then it was clear that there is some technology to be made here. And the first ideas were actually of this guy, Steve Wisner. And his first insight, or second insight, was about coding. So the amount of information there is in a qubit. So it's a very interesting question, what is the amount of information? At first sight it seems, well, it's not so clear, but maybe the amount of information is exactly just in a classical coin. So it's log 2. So Alice can only send one with the coin, a given unit of information. If she has two coins, she can send one unit of information, and then she can send another unit of information. But it doesn't matter, with the second coin, she can only send one unit of information. In the quantum case, if you write on an entangled basis, so she can send one unit of information, suppose the first one in this basis, which has no information, then she can locally go between these four states and send the other qubit. And this way, in one run, she can actually transfer two units of information. So that's an interesting point, that the information in the quantum setting is different than the classical one. That has implications for technology. His first insight was about quantum cloning. So we know that we can't clone the wave function. So what does it mean? And his idea was that we can actually create quantum money like this, so to have a number, but that's some kind of quantum number, which will be, so classical one we can clone, but the quantum one we can't clone. And his idea was we can write the number m, a set of measurements, a set of qubits or photons, in one out of two bases, and the basis, the serial number of the bases is written in the bank, and if we're measuring, we will collapse the money, and then basically we can falsify. And that was, so that idea was left unnoticed for a long time. So Bennett helped him to publish that, and until then Bennett and Vassal actually transformed this to a cryptographic protocol in the 84. We usually got the book this year. So there are many quantum technologies now. The most disruptive one is a quantum computer. And the idea, in a simple word, is we have a classical computer, so a classical computer can be in any of these states, so at the end we have n bits, it's going to be 2 to the n possibilities, but a quantum computer can be in superposition in all of these, so maybe you can make, make 2 to the n calculations at one instant of time. So we know it's not really correct, but there was some good science, and this is the factoring algorithm of Shor that shows that the was a sign that maybe a quantum computer is much stronger than a classical computer. We know it's not so easy, but the question is still not solved. And there were the ideas that are, well, people say it's due to Feynman, it's not so clear, but it's possible whether it's whatever the complexity of this machine is, we can still, we know that we can't do numerics of quantum problem, so we can just build the analog of the problem that we want to study and just do an experiment and study. So it's like a numerical way to do it, even though we don't need any proofs for the whole test. So based on those two things, there are many, this field was hyping in the last few years, and there are many, so this is a partial list of quantum computings, so there are some, so there are at least two companies that try to create quantum computings out of ions, there are also some things in the U.S. Army, this one does with photons, and yeah, this is IBM, Google, and there's a long list of companies. So many of those, there are secrets, it's not totally clear what they have right now, but it's quite clear that this field is developing extremely fast, and there are really nice results that hopefully we will see in the next few years. So I will talk about what we are doing in terms of quantum technologies. Doesn't work with quantum computing, but deals with imaging. Another technology that we've been working for a while now, it's cryptography. And this, for this already there are, here also put a movie on it, but it was like in South Korea, already the local telephone company, because every household is connected to every other household with a fiber, you can actually pay the local telephone company and have a local key that you can distribute quantum key from every point. And the biggest project is the Chinese projects in which they want via a satellite to share a key between two points. This project is ongoing, it's a huge project, and it should start operating soon. Okay, so this was the introduction. I'll move to what we are doing. So we are working with diamonds. In diamonds and epicenters, in diamonds were hyping in the last few years due to the realization that it's possible to do quantum manipulations with defects in diamonds. Usually you do them with ions, with atoms, so they are difficult to control. But in solid state, usually the coherence times and the ability to control is not so good. But with NDs, people found out that it's actually quite good. And there are many ideas how to do that, especially for sensing, but also for quantum computing, and you see partially. And the diamond itself is an artificial diamond, that's how it looks like. But every diamond, or many diamonds, they have colors. What gives them the colors are color centers, so they are defects that are optically active. And this is exactly the defect people look for when they want to do quantum information in the solid, because if it's optically active, it will interact with photons, and if two states interact in a different way, photons will have a way to measure and to initiate. And that's what happens in the MD center. This is the structure. There is a triplet and a singlet. Singlet is somewhere up above, but this is a triplet state. I've got two holes. There's ampere, electron, and hole. And these two states, or three states, of the MS equals zero and MS one minus one, they interact in a different way with photon. This is the key ingredient. So the number of photons we see when we shine this one or this one is different. And this is possible to measure and also to initialize, because this cycle of going up and down is different for the two states. So this is the MD center is composed of nitrogen, vacancy, and free. And the first experiments were the important experiments in the field. They showed it's possible to manipulate the MD center as a qubit. And so what you see here is the manipulation in that basis from M. So MS equals 0, MS equals 1 will be the qubit. It can be manipulated by microwave. And what you see here, these are oscillations from MS equals 0 to MS equals 1, almost coherent oscillations, nice oscillation in the Bloch sphere. And this was one of the first experiments, and they've seen a very long coherence time. So the T2 was milliseconds, which is kind of unusual in the solid state. It's almost a coherence time for atoms. And first advantage here is the solid state. It's very easy to work with. You can do it at room temperature. There's no need to use a vacuum. Experiment can be set up, even in a few weeks. That's what created the big hype, and people started doing quantum information experiments with this. We were thinking mostly at the beginning about quantum computing. So what you see here, also one ingredient that we need in a quantum computer is to create a unitary operation. But we also need to measure. Measurement, QMD measurement is more tricky because it's not one photon that creates the manipulation, so it has to be mapped to a nuclei. And that's why it's very important to control nuclei, carbon 13, which are mapped to the NV. And then it was measured, so what you see here is quantum jumps, when actually quantum measurement occurs of the spin. Here it's up and here it's down, and you see that it's jumping due to the measurement. And, whenever people in this community see a graph like this, they know they can create a quantum measurement. It's a big milestone for them. So in these two experiments, it was possible to show that it's a quantum thing. It's possible to manipulate it as a quantum identity, and maybe to create a quantum computer. So what are the motivations? It's changed since then. Still, quantum computing is motivation. The main motivation is quantum sensing. So the energy gap between the 0 and plus minus 1, it depends on the Zeeman splitting, and then will change the spectrum or minus the spectrum. If a given magnetic field is in a different magnetic field, means you can measure magnetic field. So magnetic field at nanoscale is a very important thing, and this is basically the main idea behind quantum sensing with NV centers. So there are many advantages, but most of them are due because it's a very small thing. You create a very small diamond, you can bring it very close to what you ever want to measure. So it's a measurement of the field at another scale, but it's also biocompatible. So you can put it in a living cell and create the measurement in the living cell. So carbon usually does not create problems for animals or for cells. just because we are made out of carbon. And what you see here is a measurement inside the cell. You can also measure other things, electric field, pressure, temperature, many quantities, the energy that depends on one of these quantities. And here is a measurement of a neural network of the electric field created, the magnetic field created by the neural network. The main thing that people want to do here is basically, because the size is a huge advantage, so suppose to take a diamond with some surface, to put the enemies next to the surface, to bring even a single molecule next to the enemies, and to measure and to see a single molecule in real time. And this is the main goal that people are trying to achieve in quantum sensing with things. QIP, quantum information processing, is still a major goal. And there are many ideas. Here it's an idea how to put enemies in an array, and this would be a small quantum computer controlled by lasers and by wires. Other ideas, they are connected to placing spins, nuclear spins on the surface. So here we have an array of nuclear spins which can be controlled by the enemies or by the quantum computer. Also some funny ideas. This is a structure now of DNA origami. This is based out of DNA. With DNA you can do almost whatever you want. Then you put your non-diamonds in special locations, then you can create an array of nanodiamonds. So this is a small array that created enemies from nanodiamonds. And each nanodiamond will be a spin, so you can, in principle, make a quantum. So this is taken from this paper, which was the first realization of quantum error correction. So first major quantum computing work. And quantum error correction was done with the NV plus nuclei, which were fixed. So basically, whatever we do, the carbon of the nuclei, which are close to the NV, they are important in reading. And that's how we got into this field. We wanted first, so I've done the theory, and my collaborator, collaborators in the experiment, we want to control a nuclei with the NV. And what is the idea? So we can think about the NV as a single electron. It has these dipole lines. And suppose here we have a nuclei, and we want to control this nuclei. So all of this thing is located in the magnetic field. So there is, for this nuclei here, has some Larmor frequency. And now we know if we take a spin with some Larmor frequency and we drive it at the on resonance at the Larmor frequency, something will happen to the spin. It's still responding. So what is done here? So suppose we take this electron, we start rotating the electron. So if the electron will start rotating, of course the field lines and the nuclei will rotate itself. So basically, due to the rotation of the electron, the nuclei will see something like this. This will be the field that the nuclei will see. So if the rotation of the electron is done exactly at the Larmor frequency of the nuclei, we will expect that the nuclei will start rotating as well, just as the classical effect. Because it's a quantum effect, we would expect to have some feedback, so the electron will rotate as well. And basically, what we have here is an exchange of energy between the two. And this is more or less the intuition behind this control. And also there is a gradient because of this electron. So there's a gradient of the magnetic field that gives us basically all the ingredients in an MRI machine, in an imaging machine. And this is the idea behind the control of individual nuclei by an electron. So if we can control the electron, we hopefully can control the electron. And then we start making transitions of energy from one to the other at some frequency which depends on the dipole-dipole strength, on the magnetic dipole-dipole interaction between them. We can also describe it quantum mechanically, so we have a two-level system, we drive it with some Rabi frequency, with some frequency omega. We can go to some interaction picture in this Dresden basis, we just have a qubit with some energy gap omega. And whenever omega equals the Larmor frequency, so we have two spins, which effectively have the same frequency, we would expect to see a resonance effect and an exchange of energy. So basically, the electron has a different energy gap than the nuclei. We drive it at the frequency of the energy gap of the nuclei, and effectively we bring them to resonance. Then we will see some interaction and this radiation. So again, how it works, suppose we have an electron, a nuclei, there's a big gap here, we drive it with some drive, we bring those to resonance, and then we'll start exchanging energy. So since we can control the electron with a laser, we can immediately polarize it, pull it to this state. And what will happen here, because we will start exchanging energy, you will wait enough time for it to do anything, eventually also the nuclei will be in the ground state. So basically we have a nuclei at the ground state, at the given state that we want. This is important for quantum. And then we have the idea that actually this is not important only for quantum computing, but it's important also for medical imaging. So the experiment was done, actually the first author was Az Lodl, who was a student of Rudiger Schoning at the time. And that's the experiment that he did. So what you see here, these are the envies, that's how you see them. And what you do here, so you choose one envy. What you do, you first initialize this with light, you drive it at the frequency, and then you wait. And at the end, you initialize this again, you do it again, and again. Okay, so this is the introduction time, and then you wait out or initiate. And that's how it looks like. So what you see here is the effect is a function of time, is a function of omega. So you change omega, you see nothing. Eventually, when you get to the resonance, you see some resonance effect, and that means that the electron and the nuclei exchanging energy between them. And from this, you can analyze this, and you can see that actually there is a carbon which is located this amount of nanometers from the envy, and the precision, even of this first experiment, was half an angstrom. So that's why it's so important for imaging, but it's also important for polarization. So what happens in this experiment? This is a measurement of the coherence time of the electron. So the nuclei, because they are analog, they create noise on the electron. But if we put all the electrons in a down state, they cannot make any interaction anymore with one another, so they won't create any noise. So basically, if we polarize the nuclei, we will not see any noise by the envy. It's a very, very good measurement device for polarization. So what you see here is the full width of half maximum as a function of the number of interactions. You see that the coherence time goes, so this is one of the coherence time. Coherence time is improving all the time with polarization. So it means that we know that we are polarizing the nuclei. Okay, so that's important for quantum information, but it's also extremely important for medical reasons, and that's the reason why. So if you look at the regular MRI machine, which is a very important imaging tool, and that's how it looks like, and the MRI signal is usually extremely weak, because it's based on the polarization that we have, just the thermal polarization of the, it's very small, around 10 to the 5, depends exactly what the substance we look like. We still can get very nice images out of this 10 to the minus 5. Because the average, because there's lots of them, because we wait for a long time, and that's a standard tool for imaging. But there's always the question, can we improve it by using some kind of contrast agent? So something that can give us a much stronger signal. And the first idea was PET-CT, which is the gold standard for oncology. And the idea is the following. Suppose we take a glucose molecule sugar, and we change this OH with fluorine 18. That's a radioactive substance that emits positrons, which then emit photons. why is it important? This is due to an effect which is called the Van Gogh effect, which is one of the most important effects of the metabolism of the cell. So each cell uptakes glucose, transforms it to a pyruvate, and then transforms it to CO2. A cancer cell has another channel that detects the pyruvate, transforms this to lactate. It needs it for. No, the reason is not clear, but that's what it does. It means you need much more pyruvate, also you need much more glucose. And eventually the pyruvate is being transformed to lactate. So it means if we see some region in the body that takes a lot of sugar, a lot of glucose, we know there is a chance it's a cancer cell. And this is the gold standard for oncology, and that's how it works. Here you see a CT or MRI, that's how it looks like. If you see in a PET CT, you see this. These red regions, which means there's lots of metabolism. I don't know if it's due to cancer cell or whatever it is, but there's lots of metabolism. And radiologists have put an experience, we can know if it's cancer or not. But that's how it works. And there are some problems with this. First, it's very expensive, it's radioactive. It's also very difficult to know if this part here, so this is a picture of a patient who had cancer. Cancer was treated in the therapy, but it still shows very strong signs. of metabolism. And apparently here, actually, this guy is healthy. It's just that after lipotropy, that issue is damaged and still metabolizes sugar. And here comes another idea people try to develop, is to take the pyruvate itself and polarize it. So the way it's done now, and this is how the machine works, you just use brute force, you put it in a very high field, at a very low temperature, and you put the pyruvate together with unpaired electrons, and you wait until the electrons will be just polarized, just because H-bar moment and KP are comparable. And you wait long enough, it will be polarized. Then you do the same trick again. You drive it, the energy will be transferred to the pyruvate, to the carbon 13s, and you do it again and again and again. And after 1 or 2 hours, you will see something. Then you take it out, you inject it, and you see it. So what is the advantage? The advantage is the following. Suppose if you look at
the information is in the electronic spin, in the nuclear spin, in the atomic level, where is the information?
So the information always, when you treat patients, is always in the nuclear spin, because if it's in the electronic spin, it's like a microwave, so it doesn't penetrate the body. So it's always in the nuclear. And the information sits here in the nuclear. It sits in the spectrum of this molecule. Okay, I will show it to you. But the information is in the spectrum. Because if the cytokine, right, if it's polarized, it will start rotating and the dipole will give you some frequency. And you can measure this frequency, you just do this. It's not so clear, but okay, it will be clear in a minute. And so what you see here, so this is a regular MRI. This is an MRI plus PET CT. And you see here, yeah, this is a tumor, but this is what actually what you see here is a muscle was just working, so metabolizes a lot, but it's not a tumor. But you see here, this is hyperpolarized. And you see that this is a tumor, this is not. How do you see it? Because this is the information. What you see, what you get is a picture, it's a three-dimensional picture. In each voxel, you see this, you see the spectrum. Okay? That's what the machine gives you. It gives you the spectrum. So what you actually see, you see the cancer cell metabolizes, the pyruvate transforms it into lectin. You can actually see the cancer cell when it's working. You can actually see that the cancer cell takes the pyruvate, transforms it into lectin. Yeah? And then there's no ambiguity, you know. It's cancer because it transforms the pyruvate into lectin. Yeah, the muscle would not do that. It would just take the pyruvate, it would just take the sugar, but it would not metabolize it to something else. Yes. So what you get is a picture, a three-dimensional picture of spectrums. In each part of the body, you see the spectrum.
But you first inject a hyperpolarized substance. It's polarized relative to a given direction. What happens when you inject?
No, everything happens in high momentum.
Ah, I see.
Everything has to happen in high momentum.
This is one like MRI.
Well, next to the MRI, everything happens in high momentum. You don't have much time. You lose polarization after around 100 seconds or so, that's what you see, but it's still enough to see the difference. So indeed, in the end, you lose it, but it's still interesting.
The nuclear spin doesn't care about if you transport. I mean, if you polarize the nucleus in some direction, you transport it wherever you want to transport it, it still keeps the direction.
Unless there is not.
Unless there is magnetic field. And what's the direction? It's external field. That's what it's.
Unless there is noise, it's correct. But it gives you also much more information than that. So what happens here, so usually if a patient has cancer, usually it's treated with chemotherapy, and you have to wait a few months to know if the chemotherapy worked or not. It's a very precious time for the patient. Of course, if he loses this time. And what happens here, you can make the chemotherapy, and after 2 days, just see what happens. And you see here that due to this therapy, the metabolism of the cancer cell changed. So you know it is working. If not, you can try something else. So you can save a lot of time for a patient. Because you actually see, then the metabolism, you can see the cancer cell is important. You know if you manage to damage it. Okay, so what do we do? So we are doing the following. So instead of just taking the electron, putting it in a high magnetic field and very low temperature, we have advantage with the AI. We don't have to wait some long time with the AI. We can just take a single photon, and the single photon would polarize the AI with a very good efficiency. It will do it in a few hundreds of microseconds. So in the end, it's possible to get all this polarization in a matter of at most minutes, if not seconds, instead of waiting all these hours in this very machine. So we just use the same things we use for quantum computing. For us, this was the electron, and these were the qubits. And of course, the initial stage in the quantum computing was to initialize these qubits. We just initialized them, and we use this as a polarized substance.
So you polarize the C sub T,
in the
sort of has to be enriched.
Yeah, so this is enriched, but we'll wait. Somehow it's not so expensive. It is more natural. yeah, people can do it.
So what? So the patient eats and decides what the
No. Well, okay, this was, maybe I'll discuss this one. So.
But I, you don't polarize the same photo.
Okay. You have to do it. You have to do it many times, but still, each cycle is just 100 microseconds. And before it was a minute, it had a huge few minutes to. For electron in the press, we have to wait a few minutes. It became a huge problem.
Again, so what's the direction of polarization? You have to, it's an external magnetic field of the crystallographic direction. That's what defines it.
So this is external magnetic. So everything here is done it doesn't have to be solar, but it takes some it says the polarization. Just to be stronger. But this is one main of the advantages, just to be has to be stronger than the noise. It doesn't have to be as strong as the magnetic device. Okay, so there are two settings. One is to take a nanodiamond covering with glucose or whatever is interesting. And then let the patient eat it. Some people are trying to do this. This is a bit of a problematic scenario, but still is an idea that people are pursuing. The other is just take some kind of liquid that has this nanodiamond, some kind of structure that has this nanodiamonds and the pyruvate, make the transfer, make the polarization, then take the nanodiamonds out, then inject it. It sounds science fiction, but that's what they are doing with the electrons. They can do that, all of that, in a few seconds. I mean, it takes them hours to polarize, but to take it out takes them a few seconds. Or it can be something like this. Suppose we put your nanodiamonds in the gel, and nanodiamonds are here. You push something in the gel, suppose the glucose, it interacts with nanodiamonds. When it gets out, it's polarized. It's without nanodiamonds. You take it, and you inject it. Or some other structure, which is just a usual structure, regular structure, a diamond, we have enemies on the surface of the diamonds, and so the glucose is on the surface, it interacts with the envy, and in the end it's polarized, of course there's no problem with that. So this is the main structure, and the challenges we have are the following. The first challenge is that basically the glucose is diffusing in the nanodiamond zone, in whatever structure it is, it's diffusing. The diffusion coefficient or the diffusion correlation time of the energy is very large. It can be as large as 1/1, or as small as 1/1 the energy, or as large as the energy. And that creates extra energy, which actually at first was limiting the polarization of whatever. So basically what is happening is what are the challenges? Suppose we have the electron and we have the nuclei, and somehow we can make them interact. And now we wait and they can exchange energy. Now because the energy of the nuclei, of this diffusing nuclei, it has a very short correlation time, it gives us some frequency scale. And this frequency scale, even a large magnetic field, can be large enough to be comparable to this transfer. So it means there are actually two processes. In which process? In one process they can exchange energy. In the other one, they can actually take energy out of the diffusion volume. And This is one challenge that we're facing. Basically, if you look at problems, if this is the end bit in a null diamond, I'll summarize this B, it gives us some time scale. And this time scale would be, or the correlation time would be just the radius square divided by the diffusion coefficient. And if we put substances at room temperatures, like oil, it will give us this the diffusion coefficient, the typical one, will give us a very short time scale, in the order of 0.1 nanoseconds. So this is one challenge that we have to deal with somehow. And for this we have to find some optimal material or some tricks to basically prolong this correlation time. The other challenge is the uncertainty. So we have to drive it very strongly. And the problem is that the electron and the nuclei, they really have to be on resonance for the energy transfer to take place. The price on off-resonant interaction is very large. So this is the interaction, and the interaction can be quite weak as the electron, the antisender is inside the diamond, and the nuclei is outside the diamond. It can be a few hertz, 100 hertz. The driving should be very large, so suppose 100 megahertz, so 10 megahertz, 20 megahertz. The price you pay is the noise that can get to around 100 kilohertz, and this, which is around 100 hertz. So the price is basically 10 to the minus 6. So even if the noise is large, we still have to be extremely precise. So we have to somehow to increase precision by 6 or 5 orders of magnitude. And this is the challenge that we are facing. This is my role in this endeavor. As a guy who's working theoretician in quantum information, I know how to do precise operations given some experimental setup. So how do we increase the precision of the operation? And this is taken, the main idea is taken out of spin locking. It's a known effect from NMR. And it's basically a constant value. So if we take an atom, or if we take a spin and reject it some frequency, we will gain something. So first of all, to be in resonance, but we also gain coherence because we average the external magnetic field. So if we take a spin, we rotate it very, very fast, we average the noise. And that's a huge advantage for NMR, because people were doing this for 50 years probably. And indeed, the coherence time is improved so if we don't do anything, we're being killed by magnetic field at a very low frequency. But if we're doing some rotation, only the magnetic field and the frequency of rotation can create some damage. Of course, the higher the frequency, the less power spectrum the noise we have there, and that's why we gain a huge control. The problem is for this to work, we have to rotate it at a very extremely good accuracy. So I will explain you the issue again. If we want to kill the external noise, which is next to the surface, can be huge, we have to drive extremely fast to kill the noise. But if we drive extremely fast, we have to drive it at extremely good precision. So if we have to drive it at 10 megahertz, we have to drive it at a precision of 200 hertz. So we have many orders of magnitude of precision that we have. And that seems at the beginning like a huge problem. But here we can use quantum information ideas to tackle this problem. Okay, so first an experiment is done. So this the electron is driven here like 40 megahertz, so a very large drive. The coherence is lost very quickly on order of a few microseconds. And the reason it's lost so quickly is just that it's not really 40 megahertz, it's 40 megahertz plus minus something, which in each experiment is a bit different. And because of this, the coherence is lost extremely fast. It also means that the driving frequency is not known with a very good precision, because so we have to drive the electron exactly at the frequency of the nuclei. But if you know it, we can only do it at that precision, it will never talk to the nuclei, we will never see any. So here we developed a few ideas that the main ideas were taken from NMR, from SpinX, from the previous version. And the first idea was the following. So if you know that we have a electron, and we drive it at some frequency. we can write it, we can write this thing in a, we can think about it as a qubit in a different basis. And this qubit will have energy gap omega zero, but we know omega zero is noisy. Then we do it again, we drive it with omega one, which is smaller than omega zero. So if omega zero has to be much stronger than external noise, and if it is much stronger than external noise, it kills, it averages the external noise to zero, the next drive only has to be stronger than the noise in the first drive, which is much weaker. And then we do it again and again and again, and each time we add another drive until we can get any precision. Okay. So basically, we start with a drive which is not precise, but we add higher components of the drive, and in the end, what the electron sees is actually extremely precise rotation. So what we see here, this in the end will be the formula. And what we see here, so this is, so that's what happened, that's what happens when there is one drive, that's when we have two drives. Suddenly we see very nice beating, we see that coherence goes to longer and longer.
The relative phase need to be
The relative phase between the two drives has to be stable, but the important part is not late, not late, in my point.
You exchange, in a way, a requirement for Turing simulation in many, many nodes, like tones that you have in the microwave, it has to be very precise.
Yeah, so more or less, yeah, but so it's true. I mean, the phase between the microwave drives has to be constant because this gives you the end phase of the qubit. So if you know that, you know the phase of the qubit. And if you don't do it correctly, you will go back to this picture. Okay, but the phase in electronics, it's much easier to control than the laser, so people can do this video. Now, in this the case, in the end, the qubit will die after the time that you can actually control the phase in the electronics. But it still was not enough. If you make the calculation with higher order effects, you will still not reach the precision we need, but we can think about a different trick. And the other trick will be to control the phase of the microwave. The phase of the microwave, unlike the amplitude, doesn't fluctuate. So if you write something like this, when the phase behaves in the same way, if you make the right transformation, it's possible to show that we end up exactly with the Hamiltonian, which I showed you before, of two drives. But now the second drive is just the control of the phase, which is extremely precise. And what we see here, this is without this precision, so this is actually exactly what you asked. This is an experiment without the precision of the phase, but when you add the precision of the phase, this is called sample, you see it's very long difference.
This so what do you do on the phase? What are you actually modulating?
So this is, so if you forget about the phase, this is just a drive, a frequency omega zero.
Now how do you choose the omega one?
Okay, so omega 1 should be as strong as possible in order to kill the noise. Omega 1 minus omega 2 has to be equal to the Larmor frequency of the nuclei at single resonance. But the nice thing that omega 2 is extremely precise. And what we see is, so this is also it's very important, these drives in terms of biological experiments because the power is relatively small compared to parts. So what you see here is this drive inside the living cell. And what you see here, the pulse sequences, it gives you some limited time. The continuous drive brings you to T1 in the nano diamond, which is quite short here, but this this T2 is comparable to T1. Another idea we had is to take ideas from drops. So suppose we want to get a very good precision and we have some unknown parameters, it's very difficult to do that. And for clock states, that's what people basically build atomic clocks, they have the following idea. Suppose we have some magnetic noise. So we look at the Zeeman splitting, then we have the second order effects. At the beginning it's linear, but then it becomes non-linear. So there's always a point, or in more cases there's a point, in which the derivative here equals derivative here, also here and also here. So in those points, this is the Zeeman splitting of some hyperfine splitting, we see that the derivatives, both states depend on the magnetic field, but their derivative is the same. Okay. That happens in many atoms. just because there are so many parameters, you're bound to have somewhere the same derivative. So if you bring the magnetic field to this point, noise will not bother you so much. This is kind of a known used idea in atomic clocks. Anyway, so how can we use it in our case? Now we have a three-level system. As I showed you, the NB is not actually a two-level system, but a three-level system. And the idea was quite simple, was surprising how would it work. So we had some theory, and the experimenters tried to do something, and it didn't work, but they had many, was kind of a complex system, complex idea for decoupling, complex idea for polarization between drives, and many tunings, and they decalculated some other point, and it didn't work. And what we told them, listen, just start changing things randomly, and maybe we'll get, because there are so many parameters, there are so many points in which the derivative is equal, maybe something will work. So they basically started to change things randomly, and that's how easy it is when we go to multi-level scheme compared to two-level scheme. And what happens is there was a magic point in which the coherence time was increased so much. And what happened at this point, basically what happens is that everything was noisy, all the levels were noisy. But there's always a point in which the derivatives of one level equal to the other, and then the relative noise goes to zero. And that gives us an amazing precision, which is basically based on this precision, comparable to the clock precision up to the T1 in the end. So this scheme will always be limited by the T1.
Okay, the tuning is the one which you randomize?
In principle here, yeah, so we had some scheme in which the post-clock didn't work when we changed the tuning of one. But in principle, you should randomize one detuning and one amplitude. Here it worked on it. Yeah, so in the end we found the theory white more, but what's interesting here is that because of this, because you have so many parameters and so few states, you should have lots of these points, which you just change one of them, even without any theory, which is fine. And that's indeed what happened, and we got amazing precision here. And in this sense, we can basically control the energy gap of the electron at a very high precision and bring it to the point when it equals to the so okay, so I can't show you from the results of the company, but this is one of the results that we have, that my collaborators had in the lab. And what you see here is that when we bring the NB here to resonance with the nuclei which are here, at some point it starts losing population. And when we change, this experimental result, when we change the drive, eventually it will go to resonance. And then we see that there is exchange of energy, exchange of polarization, and the liquid. So before I finish, I just exactly on time, there are other people who try to do similar things. There was now, just this year, this paper from Australian group in Melbourne, and there were actually quite a few works from Rudy Gershoni and Stoddard, in which they polarized the bulk, not the liquid, but the bulk in the skin. And basically, this is the motivation. Here is the first setting I showed you, which you injected the end. And now we're done. Here, I will thank you for the attention.
In what is called the modern theory of polarization, there is a connection between polarization and the belly phase. Is there something similar for the super polarization?
Okay, what you can do is to. In two level system, it's kind of a trivial connection, so it's the same thing, it's just deorganized. What you can do operations on two level system in more, it's really more interesting. You have enough parameters to create the belly phase. Don't see advantage in that, but you can do that if the belly phase. I think if you do it in this way, and if you change the belly phase, it has to be something very simple. But I think if you change it in the right way, you will also see resonance with it. I don't know, probably. At least here, it's. I mean, also a rotation of a qubit in a way is a belly phase, right? just of a spin, but I don't think you mean that. But if you mean something more complicated, that in principle you can write any operation here, you can do operations here which are very phase, because you have enough parameters to close the space of the parameters. And maybe with that you can do an optimization. I'm not sure, I don't think it will help you much, but in principle, at least operations here you can do.
You say something more about the tuning here? What is the exact value? Some limitless, why do you get such resonance, but some disturbance, the means of the resonance?
Okay. That is what's nice here. I mean, if you do dynamical decoupling, there's a set of passes. What you can do here, in the end, you can, in most cases, you can go to a system which doesn't depend on that. Then you just have a matrix, 3 by 3 matrix. You can have a reference matrix. This matrix will be a function of your detuning and the omega, and the magnetic field. And now, if you go, and you can also make a derivative in terms of omega, and in terms of the Rabi frequency, in terms of magnetic field. And this will give you the change of the energy level in terms of the Rabi frequency and the magnetic field of the three levels. And there's bound to be a point at which two levels, they have the same derivative. So, I mean, just from, you know, in the end, the detuning is going to be, the tuning of the relative detuning will be on the order of the Rabi frequency. It's bound to have.
Okay, let's thank Alex again.